The learning objectives of this chapter are to establish where the responsibilities for an adequate standard of training lie, to understand the aspects of enclosed and confined space entry with which an involved individual should be thoroughly familiar, and to list a series of principles on which to base onboard and classroom training. It is the ship owner's or ship operator's responsibility to establish safety procedures, and their application is governed through the safety management system. An integral part of this application is the provision of training. Employers should provide any necessary training, instruction, and information to employees in order to ensure that the regulations pertaining to entry into dangerous, enclosed, and confined spaces are complied with. This should include recognition of the circumstances and activities likely to lead to the presence of a dangerous atmosphere, identification of the hazards associated with entry into dangerous spaces, and the precautions to be taken, the use and maintenance of equipment and clothing required for entry into dangerous spaces, guidance and instruction for drills on rescue from dangerous spaces. The appropriate personnel should also receive training in risk assessment. Employees are legally and contractually required to participate in safety training. That means they must attend scheduled training sessions, read and understand applicable safety manuals, circulars, and other safety-related material, and actively engage in the safety system on board the vessel. They will also be required to attend shore-based safety courses, as dictated by their national administration and company practice. Such an attitude is also in keeping with the practice of good seamanship and is a common-sense approach to safe working practice. It may also save your life. The safety management system will include a planned program of training to be followed on board the ship, and the master is responsible for ensuring that it is properly adhered to. While a certain amount of training can be considered generic in nature, this is not the case where safety equipment is involved. You should always ensure that the appropriate instruction manuals are available for the particular equipment in use on board your vessel. The degree of realism employed in safety drills is important. A careful and safe balance must be achieved between duplicating realistic conditions and placing personnel unnecessarily at risk. If practicing rescue from an enclosed or confined space, it must be in a safe condition for entry. Such drills should never be conducted in an unsafe or suspect atmosphere under any circumstances. All precautions normally applicable to enclosed or confined space entry should be in force, as well as additional measures to ensure that the drill follows the planned format. A risk assessment must be carried out prior to holding a drill that will involve personnel practicing in such circumstances. Rescue from an enclosed or confined space is a difficult and demanding task and requires personnel to enter an environment in which someone else has already become a casualty. The rescue team must prepare by way of exercises and planning so that they are prepared for any emergency. This should also involve understudies for each role in case a member of the team is actually the casualty inside the space. In particular, the rescue team should be thoroughly familiar with breathing apparatus, resuscitation equipment, harnesses and stretchers, hoisting equipment, communication procedures, and potential hazards in specific areas of the ship. There are some very clear bullet points on which to build a lesson on entering enclosed or confined spaces. These are again generic points, and specific items of importance directly related to the type of vessel or cargo should be added as applicable. If in doubt, stay out. The greatest risk is from the atmosphere inside the space. Don't take shortcuts. Check and continue to check. Poor planning leads to poor performance. Think it through, write it down, and follow the plan. Work as a team. A life may be at risk. Look after the equipment. You never know when you may need it. Know how to operate the equipment. Ask questions and practice. A superintendent was visiting a vessel to carry out an annual inspection. As part of the inspection, he was to enter and examine the condition of the ballast tanks. The vessel had a double skin, and the ballast tanks extended from the double bottom around and up the sides of the ship. All had a centerline division, thus creating port and starboard tanks. Access was achieved through manhole covers on the main deck, close to the ship's side. The ship's management team were prepared for the inspection, and the chief officer had emptied and ventilated a number of tanks prior to arrival alongside. Enclosed space entry procedures, as detailed in the company safety management system, were being satisfactorily followed. The superintendent entered a number 3 starboard ballast tank, accompanied by the deck cadet. An AB was detailed as watchman at the after manhole cover, and a mechanical, air-driven ventilation fan was running on the forward manhole cover. Both the superintendent and the deck cadet were carrying portable flashlights, and the deck cadet had a portable radio, which put him in contact with both the officer of the watch and the chief officer. The superintendent also carried a camera, which he was using to make a photographic record of the inspection. The vessel had recently landed moderately heavily against the corner of a berth, and there was an indentation in the shell plating in this tank, as well as a damaged stiffener. The two men descended vertically partway down the tank, and then moved forward along a longitudinal stringer to the location of the damage, quite close to the forward bulkhead, which divided number 3 starboard ballast tank from number 2 starboard directly forward. There was some noise from the fan above, which also blocked out any additional light that might have been available through the open forward manhole cover. The restricted width of the space meant that the two men had to move in file, the superintendent leading. When they reached the indentation, the superintendent brought out his camera and took a few shots from aft, holding the flashlight and camera together and playing the light beam onto the damaged area. He then turned, handed his flashlight to the deck cadet, and instructed him to direct the beams from both flashlights in a similar manner, while he took a few more pictures. The superintendent then moved a couple of meters forward, all the time facing aft, until he was ahead of the damage. He raised the camera to his eye and framed his picture. He could not quite include all the detail he needed, so he eased his way further forward. At this point, he fell backwards through a lightning hole in the stringer. He managed to catch himself as he fell, but suffered 3 fractured ribs, bruising and cuts to both shins and forearms, and severe shock. Neither man had seen the danger, as the flashlights were being used to highlight the area of damage. The superintendent was moving backwards, and was between the deck cadet and the lightning hole, thus obscuring any view that he might have had. The nature of the space meant that it was impractical to rig any kind of defensive barrier around every hole in every stringer, but the superintendent should have been alert to the dangers presented by the structure.